John Pearson here from the Lower Thames. I had a great opportunity of meeting with them a couple weeks ago, and they've been in this business for a long time, conservation. So, Don, here's your floor on this.
Thanks, Rick. Well, first of all, thanks for lunch.
Thanks.
And thanks for the initiative when Rick and his group came out to meet us back around middle of September. I was not aware of the initiative, but it resonated in so many levels with what we're trying to do. So my initial thought was, these guys are rolling, better get out of the way. Secondly, how can we help them? And so we thought of a number of things. I mean, obviously we deal with a lot of school-age children in terms of programs, and a lot of this fits within the curriculum that we're speaking about and demonstrating. We own a lot of properties that could lend themselves to managing more and more for the habitat and actually participating in the, specifically in the bee production. We work with a lot of landowners, stewards, a lot of agricultural producers. We primarily do reforestation, wetlands, tallgrass prairie, those kinds of things. This is just an enhancement, if you will, to that kind of outreach. When we go out to talk to somebody, you're not really talking about what you want to do, you're talking to them about what they want to do with their land, what they see, and we try and kind of marry that with the resources that we have. Also mentioned to Rick that, again, we have a couple of vehicles that could assist financially, not just our network and perhaps access to grants, but as a registered charity, the authority, the foundation, are both possible vehicles that we could use to basically flow through money. Donor gets a receipt, pollinator gets the proceeds, and you know, it helps to kind of grow that. So I think, yeah, there's an opportunity.
Maybe a seed collection program.
Yeah, all possibilities.
Maybe so, that's the word you can talk about.
And again, our authority from the standpoint of dealing with the Phragmites issue, we, on our own properties, we've, you know, worked with other experts in that area to try and control it. It is expensive. It really does need a full court press from everybody. You know, with invasive species, the best thing that you can do is prevent them from getting here in the first place. When they do arrive, it's that early response, that's the time that you have the best chance. But we're always late. We're late recognizing, we're late responding, we're late getting the critical mass we need, funding, whatever, and it gets out of hand. And when it gets out of hand, you have a big problem until, you know, the next big problem comes along and kind of knocks it away. So, you know, things kind of adjust, but Frag is one that's...
You're mentioning education for the kids.
Yeah.
They don't get that type of education about the bees and
we do in our outdoor education program, when we talk about insects and pollinators, and it was interesting that you mentioned that, again, people love birds, and when you turn 50, apparently you have an epiphany, and you start looking at birds, and they appear, and you know, they're there. But it is absolutely right that birds depend on the insects, which depend again on the native. So, to the extent we can, and the other hat that I wear, I'm actually on the board of Carolina Canada Coalition, and as you know, we're in that part of Ontario that, because of our proximity to the Great Lakes, we have a lot of species here that are relatively unique to this geography. We're also home, and whether this is good or bad, 75% of the rare and endangered species in Canada actually exist in our area. So what it means is you're a cup is half full kind of a person. The habitat requirements are there, they're under pressure. We need to kind of reverse that. We talk about creating resilience on the landscape. You know, the weather gets wonky, invasives. You need to keep the landscape healthy. And we obviously now, I think Bev alluded to that in agriculture, starting to kind of get the idea that sustainability is not just about maximizing production, but it's health of the, keeping the land healthy, keeping the soil healthy. Keeping soil healthy means you gotta keep the microbes and things in there that are supposed to be in there working. And you know, you can't sort of poison everything to try and select, you know, this is what I want, because you're always gonna have consequences that you haven't foreseen. So we're starting to kind of get it. We're starting to understand that everything is really connected to everything else. And you know, you do one thing, again, without regard for the consequences somewhere else, you're gonna get in trouble. And that's a lot of our landscaping issues that come from, you know, ornamental plants, imported. they get out of hand. So we're doing this program, it's run for 3 years now in April, so watch for it. It's called Go Wild, Grow Wild. It happens at the Agriplex at Western Fair. And it actually, St. Williams has been an exhibitor there for the past few years. And it's kind of bringing together a group of you know, businesses, entrepreneurs, et cetera, who are, you know, we're kind of looking for who's that audience, what's missing. It's not, you're not going to go there if you want to, you know, change your kitchen. But if you want to convert your lawn, for example, to something where, you know, you are in fact growing habitat and that kind of thing, then you'll find the people there that can do that. So we have, we're all about networks, all of us here. We have our own networks, and this is an opportunity to connect some of those networks, and, and really I can see this just growing like a topsy. The final point I'll make, our office is in Chatham, and about 3 years ago, the municipality, which found itself the reluctant owner of a brownfield, which was a former gas station, decided that the property was in a surplus list. It was right next door to our administrative office. We knew there were hydrocarbons and residuals from the car fueling and that was what. So they gave it to the authority for a dollar if we would take on the risk of doing the environmental assessment and seeing what it needed. Bottom line was, for $30,000 we wound up with the site cleaned, and we incorporated into a stormwater management, a native garden around it, which collects the stormwater, filters it, so nothing runs into the city sewers. It's all been planted with native plants, which are drought resistant, which if you're in Chatham Kent, drought resistance is really important, because you're either getting no rain, or you're getting a hell of a lot of it, you never seem to get average. So this year we had one milkweed plant, had six monarch caterpillars, and within about a week and a half, it had three chrysalises on it. And two of them came into the office. They hatched two monarchs in about a week. They were tagged and released. And the one outside, actually it took it 2 days longer to mature outside, but it kind of flew away. So that's one plant. And if you think about what the potential is out there on the landscape all over, if we're planting the right stuff, nature will look after itself.
Thank you. In conclusion today, the reason I got this picture up here, this is my grandson, he's sitting on a sack of seeds. See, we're not doing this for us, we're doing it for these guys. Alright, because if we keep on doing what we've been doing, there won't be a tomorrow. So that's the whole reason this is being done, the future, for these little guys.